Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the 13th General Thimayya Memorial Lecture. I request everyone to please stand for the school song. Standing in remembrance of those friends of the lecture who have passed away during the year. Please be seated. Trustees, the General K.S. Thimayya Memorial Trust, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to the 13th edition of the General K.S. Thimayya Memorial Lecture. As all of you know, this lecture series is an endeavor to commemorate the memory of an exemplary Cottonian, General Kondanera Subeya Thimayya, Padma Bhushan, a distinguished soldier of the Indian Army who served as Chief of Army Staff between 1957 and 1961. We are honored today to have in our midst General Thimayya's grandson, Mr. K.C. Beliappa, himself an old Cottonian. I would also like to welcome our patrons, General S. K. Jetley and Air Marshal Osman, their wives, other distinguished old Cottonians, veterans, and other guests. Thank you, present and former school staff, as well as students of the Bishop Cotton Boys School, for your presence on this occasion. The General K.S. Thimayya Memorial Lecture Series was instituted to pay tribute to a distinguished Cottonian, Indian, and human being by inviting an eminent old Cottonian to render a keynote address on a subject of public relevance. The underlying tribute is to our alma mater, Bishop Cotton Boys School. Recent lectures have included topics as diverse and interesting as looking at the world through the prism of science and religion, and karma, innovation, and India's economic story. I personally enjoyed the completely contrasting philosophical and scientific approaches that Dr. Rahul Rao and Dr. Rohan Murthy took in the topic creativity and academia a couple years back. Continuing the list of luminaries who have graced this occasion in the past, I'm delighted and honored to introduce Mr. C.K. Ganguly, former co-founder and chief functionary of the Timbaktu Collective and an Ashoka Fellow. Mr. Choitresh Kumar Ganguly, or Bablu as he's fondly called, was born in Mumbai and moved to Bangalore for his schooling at Cotton's. He went to Elphick House and graduated with the batch of 1973. Motivated by the Jayaprakash Narayan movement, Mr. Ganguly moved to the villages of Andhra Pradesh in early 1978. Since then he has been involved with human rights issues of agricultural laborers, marginal peasants, women, and children. Over time, his work and personal orientation has moved from direct political action and agitational politics to one of building ecological and food security for the communities that he lives with, and to nurture constructive politics and dissent. Mr. Ganguly, who studied commerce at Bangalore University, worked as a political and theatre activist for 12 years. His theatre experience helped him understand the knowledge and wisdom of rural India. Mr. Ganguly was elected to the Ashoka Fellowship in 1993 for showing people how to carry out protection and regeneration in rural India. He also helped with the regeneration of degraded, drought-ridden lands in South India. He has developed a holistic approach to regeneration, which successfully rebuilt an agroforest habitat on a 32-acre piece of land situated in one of the worst drought-affected areas in India. He is currently the chief functionary of the Timbaktu Collective, whose vision is to have rural communities take control of their own lives, govern themselves, and live in a social, gender, and ecological harmony while maintaining a suitable lifestyle. The collective works in over 172 villages in the Anantapur district, reaching and serving over 20,000 marginalized families. In 2017, the collective has received the prestigious Lush Spring Prize Award under the Established Projects category for work in social and environmental regeneration. Sir, on behalf of the Bishop Cotton Boys School and the General K.S. Thimayya Memorial Trust, I would like to warmly welcome you in our midst. We are honored and delighted to have you addressed this gathering. I now hand over proceedings to Managing Trustee, Mr. Aditya Sondi. Thank you.
Shahu Chhatrapati Maharaj of Kolhapur. He was known as Shahu Bhosle in cottons and belongs to the batch of 1963. He was a boarder. Like Bablu, he too went to Elphick House, which is a bit of a rarity in these lectures. Carrying our colors high always, knowing it's all for the blue and gray. A product of the Indore Christian College in History, Economics and English Literature, Shahuji serves as the chairman of the Chhatrapati Shahu Vidyalaya Board, President of the All India Sri Shivaji Memorial Society, and the Patron-in-Chief of Bhavans Primary School and the Kolhapur Sports Association. Significantly, he has worked tirelessly for the upliftment of the economically and socially backward citizens of his district, in recognition of which he received the prestigious Ambedkar Ratna Puraskar from the then Prime Minister, Sri V.P. Singh. Veterans and serving officers in the audience will be happy to know that Shahuji maintains an intimate relationship with the armed forces, especially the Maratha Light Infantry. We have a picture here of General J.J. Singh visiting Kolhapur to call on Shahuji after he became the first chief from the MLI in 2006. We're particularly honored to have in our presence today the Colonel of the MLI, General Pannu. Sir, may I request you to please stand up and be recognized. Thank you, General Pannu and Mrs. Pannu, for being with us today. In keeping with this tradition, Shahuji has visited practically every regimental center in the country and has left no stone unturned to improve the lot of the Jawans and their families, especially war widows and their children. Shahuji was instrumental in raising funds for the Kargil relief operations, as also for the relief work after the Koyna, Kolhapur, and Latur earthquakes. Personally, Shahuji is keenly interested in football and wrestling. I believe he played football at Cottons and also in wildlife photography, has traveled wide in connection with his passion for wildlife. We are deeply honored to have with us Mrs. Yadnaseni Raje Chhatrapati, their children Sambhaji Raje and Maloji Raje, their wives, the grandchildren, Shahuji's brother Sangram Singh Bhonsle Saab and Mrs. Bhonsle, and many, many friends who I personally welcome who have joined us today from Kolhapur, from Pune, and from Mumbai. For your continued philanthropic service, Sri Shahu Chhatrapati, may I please invite you on stage to receive the General K.S. Thimayya Medal. General S.K. Jaitley, sir, please.
The patron of the Old Cottonian Association, General Jaitley, my friend Aditya Sondi, who is the Advocate General of the Karnataka government. We have with us General Pannu, he was just introduced, Colonel of the Regiment of the Maratha Light Infantry, Sir Sangram Singh Bhosle, my brother, K. Captain Shivaji Madka from the Gurkhas, my friend, Sambhaji Raje, Member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha, Maloji Raje, MLA from Kolhapur, former MLA from Kolhapur, and Secretary of Sri All India Memorial Society, Sri Karthik Ghorpade, son of former Finance Minister M.Y. Ghorpade of Karnataka, and many other luminaries who are not only from the army, but from all spheres of life. Today we don't have amongst us Principal John Zachariah, who is gone for some meeting in Dehradun, but we do remember him today. Mr. Sumit Shetty, an old Cottonian. My friend Prithviraj Paul, who was with me in school. And so many others. We have all gathered today, as you all know, for the General K.S. Thimayya Memorial Lecture and the medal which has been given to me today at the hands of our patron, General Jaitley, who also happens to be the uncle. He was a former deputy chief and former his uncle was the former commanding officer of the 19th Maratha Regiment, which was the former Kolhapur Rajaram Rifles, and whom I had met once, and now I have met Mr. Jaitley, General Jaitley, today over here. I inquired from him whether he is any relative of the finance minister. He said no. Well, I'm really happy to be back here at home after a number of years, after more than 50 years to be precise, to be little more accurate. I passed out from in 63, as you were just told, and at that time, the warden was Mr. Thomas, who took great interest in the school, and a house has now been named after him, which I learned today. A fit act by the school. General K.S. Thimayya, as you all know, is also not just a general, but a general of very high reputation. He has been the first Indian brigadier and when he was given the charge of taking over Kashmir, I think he did a great job. His activity as Zojila Pass is renowned because he took up the tanks up to that pass in those days and captured the pass. Otherwise, a large part of the Kashmir which we now have, Ladakh, would have been cut off from India and taken over by Pakistan. I was just a few days back in Leh with General Pannu, who was commanding the 14 Corps over there. And had it not been for General Thimayya at that time, I don't think I could have gone to Leh. He was not only a great general, but a general who looked after the people also. Once, when he was the chief, a wife of one of the army officers was mishandled, and the command, the CO called in the army, and the army went at right pace, I would say, immediately, and took over. He was a son of the person who was mishandling the lady, was the son of a chief minister at that time. And later, I think he was paraded behind an army vehicle throughout the city of Chandigarh. Such was his, and he was questioned in parliament. What is this? He said, if I cannot defend the lives of the ladies of India, how can I defend my country? At that answer, the whole parliament had didn't have any more questions to ask him. Such was our general. The general also played a vital role before the Chinese debacle took place in 1963-62. The general had, General Thimayya had just retired. He had warned the government that unless you take proper steps, something nasty is going to happen in the along the border of India. The government didn't take enough precaution, and the Chinese walked in. Only later they realized how important a General Thimayya was. General Thimayya has also another close connection with some Kolhapur. His deputy at that time, when he was commanding the forces, peacekeeping mission in Korea, was General Thorat, who happens to be in Kolhapur and also happened to be my very, very, very senior friend and my guide too. So, a general of such a person like General Thimayya, if we can produce many more, which Cottons have been producing from time to time, and all these years, over the years, the ex-students, the Cottonians as they are called, produced a number of excellent Cottonians. Colin Cowdrey was an ex-Cottonian, the famous cricketer of England. One of my junior friends, also a cricketer, was Brijesh Patel. Admiral Shekhawat was from this school. Dr. Raja Ramanna, eminent nuclear scientist, was also a Cottonian. I had the honor to meet him once in school when he had come over here to visit the school. After, during his visit, apart from his scientific background, he also showed another side of his life, and he was also an excellent pianist, which I was honored to hear him playing the piano in the school. And recently, I think, though I don't know them, it is Nandan Lenin Kani of the famous Unique Identification Authority of India, who is changing the lifestyle of all the Indians, bringing them together under his famous Aadhaar card activity. One of my friends, who was also an ex-Cottonian, was a singer, Bidu Appaya. He was a couple of years, I think, senior to me. But I've seen him very active in the Cottons in those days. And amongst those whom you have honored, you have General Kapoor, Admiral Vadgaonkar, Admiral Naya, Ambassadors Khalili and Sinai, and many others. So as you can all see, Cottons has been always giving India citizens of repute, and those who contributed to the interest of the country. General Thimayya, as I've just said, when he was in Kashmir, I remember the school song, which I just noted down this morning once again. On, straight on, Cottonians on. Muster on the side of the right. He was always fighting for the right, like that lady officer, lady from the army. And he was always really marching like a warrior to the fight. And whenever he fought, he marked his foe clearly and struck with such might that they didn't get up again. That is how Zojila was captured, taking up all those tanks in those days to the Zojila, dismantled tanks, reassembled in Zojila, and used over there. So I'm really honored by the ex-Cottonians Association to have been honored today at the hands of General Jaitley, who is the patron of the old Cottonians, and I'm sure people like General Jaitley will always inspire, like General Jaitley and like General Thimayya, will always inspire to produce responsible citizens of the country, for the country. Recently, we have heard a lot of stories. They're not just stories, but facts. Like Professor Dabolkar, Advocate Pansare from Kolhapur, then Professor Kalburgi, who have been killed recently, and last but not least, the journalist from Bangalore, Gauri Lankesh, who was brutally murdered the other day, a few days back. It is a responsible of the country and the responsibility of the Cottonians to change this nature and bring out a society which is really fighting for the people. And the fight will be always by the people, by the Cottonians, for the people, and for the downtrodden, as you know. I'll just get back to a little of history of Kolhapur, if I am permitted to speak a couple of minutes more. Okay. As you all know, our family, the Chhatrapati family, has had a long connection with Karnataka. This is our second home. Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj laid the foundation of this Swarajya in the 18th century. Later on, this Swarajya was totally disturbed, and the Mughals had taken over the country, the western part of the Maharashtra and the whole of Maharashtra. Our family had to move out from Maharashtra, and they came right through Karnataka and went up to Jinji in Tamil Nadu. There was a time when the Swarajya movement in the 17th century was supported by the people of Karnataka, the people of Tamil Nadu, and the people of Maharashtra. Together, they fought back and won back the Swarajya. And so, today, when I come back to Bangalore, my ancestors had lived here. Shivaji Maharaj's father was a governor here under the Adil Shahi, and Shivaji brought this whole area under the Swarajya movement of those days. And so we have had a long connection, and we have amongst us today one of those who were actually always whose family had participated in the Karnataka affairs, Mr. Murarrao Ghorpade. He was the finance minister, and his son, now Karthik Ghorpade, is here amongst us, and whose family had, along with Shivaji Maharaj and later Rajaram Maharaj, had really inspired the whole of India to fight back. So we need such fighters like him, and General Thimayya, whom we have all adore, not only because he's a Cottonian, but he was a person who is to be adored and to be followed, and whose memory today General Jaitley presented me with a medal. I'm really thankful to the committee of old Cottonians who unanimously voted for this this medal today to be granted to me. And I must say, I don't say they made a wrong choice, but I must thank them for going out of the way and searching for such a person, because I had not been in touch with the school for quite some time, but they searched for it, and I think they've, I don't know if I'm the right person, but I must thank all the old Cottonians, and especially Mr. Sondhi, who's the Advocate General of Karnataka, and all his colleagues, and all the present Cottonians under Adityanath Balaji, who is the captain of the school. I think he's here just now. Where is he? Okay, anyhow, he's somewhere around. And and I also remember my school days when I was here. My school captain was Anil Thakur of the 63 batch, Chitiyappa. And one more connection with the Timayas was General Thimayya had visited our school, I think during 1960 or 61 or 62, not 62, 61, 60 or 61. And I had the honor of taking his autograph. I was one of the three who were permitted to take his autograph. One was Sunny Thakur, the captain of the school. One was Chidiyappa, from a student from my colleague from Coorg, and myself. And I searched for a photograph of that time, but I couldn't find it. But I'm sure it'll be someone may have it at I don't know, the school may have it. Anyhow, I had the honor to take his autograph, and so I must say ki I'm really honored today, once again, by the old Cottonians, and I will wish all of them, and I wish all the Cottonians who are present here today, that the school will churn them up into responsible citizens of the future and fight for the right, like Lankesh and others who have always fighting for the right of not just for rights, their own rights, but for rights of the people, right to talk. And today, as you know, I have been given just 4 or 5 minutes. But today, I'm not using my right to talk over here. I have taken permission. And I'm now going to end with best wishes to all of you present over here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Shahuji, for your powerful and most relevant message. And also thank you for reminding us of the greatness of General Thimayya, a great general and a great son of Cottons. It's an honor to have you with us today, sir. Moving on to the next stage of our event, on behalf of the benevolent fund of the trust, we have been recognizing former staff of Cottons. We present them with a citation and a check for ₹1 lakh in recognition of their service to the school. May I please invite our senior trustee, Mr. C.N. Kumar, on stage to felicitate our beloved staff for 2017. With a straight bat and had several victories, including the Grand Slam in 1972 under his belt. He had the privilege of being taught by Reverend I.L. Thomas at the United Mission School and was influenced by Reverend Thomas to join the staff at Cottons. Mr. Shankar. Thank you for being here, Mr. Shankar. 64 to 1981, and then the bursar till 1994, Mr. Cyril Vaz. Mr. Vaz has seen the school both as a teacher and as a crucial part of the administration. He is fondly remembered for going about his business with quiet efficiency. We are so glad that Mr. Vaz has attended virtually every lecture we've had till today. Mr. Cyril Vaz. Thank you, Mr. Vaz. This gentleman needs no introduction. Biology teacher for 30 years from 1965 to 1995, the one and only Mr. Nainand. Mr. Nainand's classes were perhaps the most fun ones, as we will remember. And who can forget his picture-perfect drawing of the hibiscus flower? He's with us today despite frail health, but we're deeply honored. Thank you for being here, Mr. Nainan. Another Cottonian stalwart, mathematics and Hindi teacher from 1967 to 2000, Mrs. M.B. Rukmini. Mrs. Rukmini intimidated us when we first took her classes, but only to soon become an understanding teacher who always looked out for her wards. She continues to have a deep affection for every single student she has taught, and we're very pleased that she could join us today. Mrs. Rukmini. Thank you for being here, Mrs. Rukmini. groundsman at Cotton's from 1968 to 2007 for almost 40 long years, Mr. Devadanam. When asked what else he did at school, Mr. Devadanam readily described himself as an all-rounder. Maintaining grounds, rolling out the mats, but for him and his tribe, would sport at Cotton's ever be the same? Mr. Devadanam. Thank you for being here, sir. Music master at the girls' school for a couple of years and then at the boys' school from 1986 to 1998, Mr. E.D. George. We were fairly terrorized when Mr. George joined the faculty because we had heard of his penchant for painful corporal measures. But we later discovered that these were largely untrue. Mr. E.D. George. Mr. George is still an organist at St. Mark's Cathedral, and it's a great pleasure to run into him at Koshi's from time to time. Thank you for being here, sir. Gardener of the school from 1982 to 2006, Mr. Bailappa. Mr. Bailappa worked tirelessly keeping our 14 acres of school campus lush and primed. It is these unsung heroes that we are most glad to honor as part of the Benevolent Fund. Mr. Bailappa. Thank you for being here, Mr. Bailappa. And God bless you for everything that you've done. Friends, during the year, we also had occasion to honor three of our very special former teachers. English and geography teacher from 1977 to 1997, Mrs. Mary Matthew. Better known as M squared to some of us, Mrs. Matthew always taught with grace and incision. If one managed a 55 in her geography paper, then a 1 point in ICSE, I think, was assured. It's wonderful to have you with us, Mrs. Matthew. We also recognized the mathematics teacher from 1970 to 1977, Mr. Parmashivam. Though I was not personally taught by him, my colleagues CN and others from that vintage remember him fondly as a sound teacher of a difficult subject. Thank you for being here, Mr. Parmashivam. And in absentia, English and geography teacher from 1980 to 1989, Mrs. Rukmini Srinivas. Mrs. Srinivas now lives in Boston and has recently released a delightful book on South Indian snacks and anecdotes to go with them called Tiffin. She was fondly and unceremoniously called Granny in school, though I can vouch for the fact that she doesn't look a day older now than she did back in the 80s. Her late husband, Professor M.N. Srinivas, hardly needs any introduction. Thank you, C.N. Kumar. And could we have a slide now? Ladies and gentlemen, 10 teachers, over 250 years of collective service to the school. And we're so grateful that they are with us today with friends and family. We thank them for their service. I recognize the presence of my principal, Dr. Francis Samuel, Mrs. Samuel, and many other teachers from Cotton's. We thank you too. We welcome suggestions from the alumni, for other teachers, and more importantly, the administrative staff who have served unsung for many, many years. Please help us recognize them in the years ahead. Now to the business end of the event. But first, a picture of Bablu from school. Nothing compares to those 70s haircuts. Adyant has already introduced Bablu's exceptional work to you, and I won't labor any further on that. We're very pleased that Bablu is accompanied by His family, Duhita, is here, Manisha, Ashok, and others, and friends from Timbuktu. Bablu's work is exceptional, as you will see. Before I invite Bablu to address you today, I thought we would show you a short 10-minute film which captures the changing paradigms that Timbuktu has achieved. We hope you will enjoy Dharani.
మన తల్లి ఉన్నట్లే భూమి మన తల్లికి కొడుకు ఏ సంబంధం ఉందో భూమికి కూడా మంచికి అదే సంబంధమే మనం ఎంత ఇచ్చినామో అంత మనకు ఆయమకు ఆయమకి ఎంత పెడతామో మనకు దెబ్బలు ఆయమే మనకు ఇస్తారు
ఇంతకు ముందు దాదాపు 6-7 ఏళ్ళ కిందటంతా కూడా కెమికల్ ఫార్మింగ్ అంటే మామూలు రసాయనిక సేద్యమే చేసేటవాళ్ళము
ఎట్లా బాగా జరిగింది సేద్యం అంటే బాగా మందులు ఎక్కువ వేసినంతల్లా వర్షాలు ఎక్కువ బాగా వస్తేనే రసాయన మందులు వేస్తే పంట పండేది
కాకపోతే ఇప్పుడు ఏమైందంటే సంవత్సరం సంవత్సరానికి కూడా దిగుబడి తగ్గుతూ వస్తుంది అన్నమాట
ఇప్పుడు 4 సంవత్సరాలు అయింది వర్షం లేదు ఆ మందులు వేస్తే ఎండిపోయేది అంతే
రాను రాను కనీసం పెట్టిన పెట్టుబడులు లేనికి రాకుండా చాలా అప్పులు పాలైపోయిన పరిస్థితి మాది
ఆలస్యం చేస్తే ఇది ఎట్లా ఎన్నాళ్ళు అని చెప్పి సేద్యం చేశాక అవుతుంది పెట్టుబడి ఎక్కువైతుంది కదా మనం ఈ పెట్టుబడి తగ్గించే మార్గం ఏం లేదా అని చెప్పి ఆలోచన చేసే టైంలోనే టింబక్టు కలెక్టివ్ వాళ్ళు ఈ ఆర్గానిక్ సంఘాలు సేంద్రియ వ్యవసాయ సంఘాలు అనేటివి మేము ఏర్పాటు చేస్తున్నాము మీరు కూడా మీ గ్రామంలో ఎవరన్నా ఉంటే మీరు సంఘం ఏర్పాటు చేసుకొని చేరండి అని చెప్పి అన్నారు అన్నమాట అంతకుముందు సేంద్రియ వ్యవసాయం అంటే ఏమనేది మనకు పూర్తిగా తెలియదు
మాకు ఫస్ట్ అనుకున్నాము ఈ రసాయన మందులు లేకుండా పట్లండే పంటలు ఎట్లయితే పండించకైతుంది ఇదంతా మాటలో ఎవడు పండుతాయప్ప పంటలు అనుకున్నాము కానీ ఈ పెట్టుబడులు లేక పరిస్థితి కొంచెం అద్మానంగా ఉండే తలకే వ్యవసాయం పైన పెట్టుబడులు సరే సేంద్రియ వ్యవసాయం బాగుందనేతో ఫస్ట్ టింబక్టు సంస్థ ద్వారా మేము సేంద్రియ వ్యవసాయానికి మొట్టమొదటిగా ముందడిగేసాం
అప్పుడు మేమంతా కూడా మా ఊర్లో 30 మంది రైతులు ఏర్పాటయ్యి మేమంతా కూడా 2 సంఘాలుగా ఏర్పడి సేంద్రియ వ్యవసాయ సంఘంలోకి మేము దిగినామన్నమాట అప్పటి నుంచి మేము కొద్ది కొద్దిగా మారుకుంటూ వచ్చి పూర్తి సేంద్రియంలోకి దిగినాం టింబక్టు వాళ్ళు మాకు పశువులు పట్టించినారన్నమాట పశువులు సేద్యం చేసేదానికి పూర్తి సేంద్రియంగా సేద్యం కావాలంటే పూర్తి పశువులు ఉండాలా పశువులు లేనిదే మనము సేంద్రియం సేద్యమే అనిపించుకోదు అన్నమాట ఆవులు పట్టించి ఆ ఆవుల నుంచి మళ్ళా సేంద్రియంలో గట్లెప్పించి ఈ కుంటలు కట్టించి ఈ ఫిట్లు తవ్వించినారన్నమాట ఈ కంపోస్టులు చేసుకునేదాన్ని ఫిట్లు తవ్వించి ఇన్ని రకాలుగా సహకారం అందించి ఈ రైతుల్ని సేంద్రియం వైపు ఆకర్షించి రైతులు బాగుపడేదానికి ఒక మార్గం చూపినారన్నమాట
ఇప్పుడు ఇదైతే మనం మన సేంద్రియంగా అయితే కొంత ఆకులు అలములు వేపగింజలు ఇలాంటివి సేకరించుకొని దానిలో రుబ్బి మామూలుగా పొలాలు కలుపుకున్నాం ఇది శ్రమ ఎక్కువ ఉండదు అది శ్రమ తక్కువ అన్నమాట కాకపోతే బడ్జెట్ ఎక్కువవుతుంది ఇది 0 బడ్జెట్ భూమి అంటే కెమికల్ వాడడం వల్ల ఏమైందంటే దాంట్లో ఉండే సూక్ష్మజీవులన్నీ చనిపోయినాయి అన్నమాట చనిపోయి భూమి అంతా గట్టి బారిపోయింది తర్వాత వచ్చేసి మన సేంద్రియంగా వాడిన తర్వాత ఎందుకంటే భూమి అంతా మెత్తగా అయిపోయి గుళ్ళబారి ఆ ఎరువులు ఎరలు అవన్నీ మళ్ళా సూక్ష్మజీవులు తయారయ్యి మళ్ళీ మామూలుగా ఇప్పుడు మెత్తబడింది అన్నమాట భూమి
అక్కడ ఒక మూట కొనాలంటే 800 రూపాయలు
ఈ ఎరువు మనం ఇది సేంద్రియ వ్యవసాయం చేసుకున్న ఎరువు చేస్తాం కాబట్టి మొత్తం ఒక ఎకరా పెట్టాలంటే 6,000-7,000 రూపాయలు మనకు తగ్గిపోతుంది.
మెథడాలజీ ఆఫ్ టింబక్టు అడాప్ట్ చేస్ ఇట్ డజంట్ ఫోకస్ ఆన్ ద అవుట్పుట్, ఇట్ ఫోకసెస్ ఆన్ ద ప్రాసెస్. హియర్ ద ప్రాసెస్ ఇస్ ద కమ్యూనిటీ షుడ్ టేక్ ఓవర్ ఎవ్రీథింగ్. దే షుడ్ నాట్ డిపెండ్ ఆన్ ఎనీబడి. Like now, we have to buy fertilizer from outside. You have to pay huge money. You have to buy credit. You have to go to bank. You have to depend on insurance. You have to go to government. Now, the entire effort is all the inputs required for organic farming should be within the reach of farmer to create on their own. Then only they can sustain it. So instead of outsourcing to any individual or market or government, we are trying to outsource to nature.
ధరణి నుంచి ఏమంటే రైతులకు ముఖ్యమైన ఉపయోగం ఏమంటే బయట దళారీల బెడద తగ్గుతుంది, అదే కాకుండా మంచి ధర దొరుకుతుంది రైతులకు. అది తూకాల్లో కూడా మోసం లేకుండా కూడా ఉంటుంది. ఆ దానిలన్నింటిలో కూడా కలిపి మార్కెట్ బయట మార్కెట్ కన్నా ధరణిలో ఎక్కువ ధర లభిస్తుంది.
ఇన్ ధరణి బిజినెస్ వి డీల్ విత్ ఆర్గానిక్, we deal with rain fed, and we deal with small and marginal farmers. These things are against business, because small and marginal farmers gives very small produce from remote place, but business requires large scale. Second one, rain fed. Rain fed does only gives only one produce, but actually in business you need continuous produce to serve the ever increasing demand of urban market throughout the year. And third one is organic. Market doesn't believe in farmer. You need somebody to say farmer is producing so and so produce as per organic, which is cost intensive. So these things make our business very difficult. Means we have to struggle at every stage to be successful.
The farmer, what he gets is hardly 30% of the money is paid by the consumer is being transferred to the producer. So all the middlemen will eat away this big chunk of 70%. So Dharani intervenes here and gives maximum support in terms of exact weighing, processing, value addition, packing and selling it with our own brand, that is Timbaktu Organic.
ఈ సేంద్రీయ వ్యవసాయానికి చేరిన తర్వాత మా భూమి బాగుపడింది, మాకు పశు సంపద ఉంది. దానికి తోడు మేము పండించిన పంటను మాకు ధరణి సొసైటీ కొంటా ఉంది కాబట్టి 5% రూపాయ ఎక్కువగా మేము ఇంకా ఆనందంగా ఉండుకు మాకు ఆనందంగానే ఉన్నాం. రైతుని అంత తక్కువగా అంచనా వేసేయలేదు. రైతు ఏమైనా చేయగలడు, రైతు లేదా ప్రపంచమే లేదు.
అందరు రైతులకు కూడా మన ఆరోగ్యాలు చెడబెట్టుకోకుండా మన జీవితాలు ఎందుకు నాశనం చేసుకోవాలా?
పూర్తి మంది రైతులు అంటే ఇంకా ఇప్పుడు మమ్మల్ని చూసుకొని మాలాంటి రైతులను కూడా ఈ సేంద్రీయ రైతులను చూసి ఇంకా కొద్ది కొద్దిగా మారుతున్నారు.
ఇంతకు ముందు అయితే వేరే వాళ్ళ చేతిలో నిర్ణయాలు ఉండే, ఇప్పుడు ధరణి తీసుకున్నాక మన చేతుల్లోనూనే ఉంటాయి నిర్ణయాలు. మనమే చేస్తాం కాబట్టి, మనం అందరూ కలిసి పనిచేస్తాం కాబట్టి మన చేతుల్లోనే ఉంటాయి నిర్ణయాలు. సేంద్రీయ వ్యవసాయం చేస్తూ నేను నా కుటుంబం సంతోషంగా గడుపుతున్నాను.
నేను సేంద్రీయ వ్యవసాయం చేయడం వల్ల నేను నా కుటుంబము ఇతర కుటుంబాలకు కూడా ఎక్స్పోజ్ చేసే విధంగా మాకు మంచి జరిగింది. ఈ మాకు మంచి జరిగింది కాబట్టి మీరు కూడా ఇట్లా చేసుకోవడం వల్ల మంచి జరుగుతుందని చెప్పడానికి కూడా ఆస్కారం.
ఇది కనీసం మహాసముద్రంలో టింబక్టు నీటి పొడుగు లాంటి టింబక్టు సంస్థ మా 1,250 రైతులకు సహాయం చేస్తాను. ఇంత పర్యావరణాన్ని మేము కాపాడినాము, అదే మా ప్రభుత్వం అయితేనేమి మాకు మమ్మల్ని ఆదరించి మాకు ఇచ్చేస్తే మేము ఇంకా ఎక్కువ సేంద్రీయ రైతులు ముందుకు వచ్చే అవకాశము ఉంది.
So what Dharani has done, we created with one individual alone you cannot fight the market, you cannot fight the government, you cannot fight anybody. You have to come together, put hands together, then we will fight against anybody who is not treating us favorably. And that thing created self-respect, created value-based buying, value-based selling, value-based production system.
I passed out some 44 years ago.
I think we were the second last batch of the senior Cambridge students, and many of my teachers are here. Mr. Nainan taught me that I shouldn't eat more than 2 eggs because in a day. I mean, I could tell you stories about each one of them. Dr. Parameswaran, I really miss his 2 minutes silence. Every day we used to stand outside the tower block and we used to have a quiet session and he would say, 2 minutes silence. And then we would have to stand and then he'd keep a look at the watch because he was a mathematics student. So exactly 2 minutes, okay. Before that, we were not allowed to move. But I really use that 2 minutes every day, even today. Mr. Shankar, Ms. Rukmani, I mean, Mr. Vaz, it's so great to see you. So great to see you. Every morning, I was a day scholar here, and actually, this was more my home than my house, which was just down the road on Hayes Road. And Mr. Vaz was always there at the gate. And we had to go past his house every time. So sometimes he would ask me, what are you doing here at 9:30 in the night? Oh, sir, I had to give some papers, you know. I was actually passing these letters from the girls' school to the boys' school. Some of you guys know it, huh? Well, we had no girls here, so whatever. To tell you the truth, I'm actually quite nervous. I mean, I have, over the years, spoken to only people who are already converted or nearly converted. But here, all of you, I don't know how many of you have actually gone to the villages or seen what the situation is there. So it's a real challenge for me and to try and explain what we are doing. So please bear with me because coming back to the school and standing in this auditorium does make one feel nervous. Even at 61, that's a good feeling. The first time I did do a or face the audience of this size was in the hall, which used to be on the other corner there. And we did our play, Romeo Juliet in a Rush, a 40-minute concise of Shakespeare. Okay, so I'll get back to my job here. I've been working in the villages for the last 40 years, straight after college. You know, we had the emergency at that time. And we had our college, the Christ College. I studied in Christ College after Cotton. Was one of the only colleges that allowed the union to function. And we had started closing down all the colleges, etc., in retaliation against the emergency. And around that time, there was a great man called Jayaprakash Narayanji, who gave a call to a lot of young people from, gave a call to the young people from the universities saying that, you know, stop wasting your time, go to the villages and start working with the people to have a total revolution to make the India that truly Gandhiji and others talked about. So many of us went. Quite a few young people went into the villages, and I was one of them. So what I'm going to tell you is part of the story. I went on April 1st, 1978, you know, April Fool's Day. And since then, I haven't really come back to the city. I've been living there since 1978. So Timbaktu Collective is an organization that me, my partner, and myself, we started. And many of you may know the word Timbaktu. Have you heard the word Timbaktu? The nowhere, nowhere land. Basically, that's what we named this place. You know, that's where it's situated, more or less in the center of the south of the Deccan Plateau, just about 170 kilometers from here. It used to be one of the important centers of the Vijayanagara kingdom. In fact, Sri Krishna Devaraya built his summer palace there and was the last stand that the Vijayanagara kingdom took before it retreated under the attack from the Bahamani kings. And it was one of the most forested areas. The cheetah was there till 1920s. Mr. William Prager, who is an old student from here and who was one of our old distinguished Cottonians, used to tell me that in 1920, when they went to Penaconda, somewhere near where I live, they camped in a place called the Penaconda Fort, and they were not allowed to come out of their tents. He went as a scout camps, you know. And they were not allowed to come out of their tents after 6 o'clock in the evening because of the wild animals and the cheetahs there. Today, of course, in 1947, we had 11% forest area. Today, we have less than 1% forest area. This is more or less the, can we have some, those lights shut off? It's so dry that we have less than 1% forest cover. You can see it's all bald. And that's the general scenario in the place that I live in. So after about 12 years of work, doing agitational work, we formed the Federation of Andhra Pradesh Agricultural Laborers Union with about 300,000 members, etc., etc., doing strikes for wages, strikes for land, etc. We decided that we would try and do things made of bamboo, bamboo mats, and thatch cover, which was from the hill surrounding it. You can see the hills were completely bare. We had at that time about 21 species of flora and almost no wildlife of any sort. And that's what it looks like now. This has really nothing to do with me. This is nature doing her job. All we have to do is protect, see that there's no fires, no cutting, no overgrazing, etc. And from 21 species of flora, now we have over 400 species of flora in this place. Yeah. That's a small little school that we run there. And of course, I'll tell you more. Now, basically, we bought this land in 1990. And then in 91, we started working on those hills, just like I told you. And then in 92, we began working in the villages. Mary, my partner and wife, we started working in 10 villages with the women and with the children. And today we are working in 172 villages in partnership with about 20,000 families. We have organized and promoted about 13 mutually aided cooperative societies. And I'll tell you a little bit about the work that we've been doing. So our vision basically is that we hope rural communities will be able to take control over their own lives. They'll govern themselves and live in social and gender harmony and maintain a sustainable lifestyle. That's our vision. The strategy to do that basically, I mean, what we've been doing is trying to empower women, children, youth, people with disabilities, farmers, artisans, laborers, all to work together. We've been trying to promote sustainable, viable producer organizations. We've been regenerating the ecology, and we have been trying to revitalize the local economy. Many of you may not understand what is this business of revitalizing the local economy. If time permits, I will try to explain later, but I will move on to tell you what all we've tried to do, the interventions that we've made. So our first work is our work with women, which I'll explain a little later. Our work with children, then we worked with ecology, then we worked with people with disabilities, then we worked with the farmers and our work on developing producer business organizations. So the women's cooperative and the work that we did with women was basically to create independent women's organizations that are financially inclusive, that allow women to become financially included in our society. And so the story, basically the timeline is that in 92 we started working with these women. In 98 we registered the first cooperative. Then in 99 we registered the second cooperative. In 2001 we registered the third, and then in 2011 we registered the fourth cooperative, and then federated the whole lot, and which is called Mahashakti Federation. Some little photographs from there of how we meet with the women, how we talk with the women, and how money is collected, etc. So basically now there are 21,973 women from 72 villages who are members of these cooperatives, and they have saved their own money of about 20 crores, which is their own money. I mean, of course, when you compare with Ambanis and Tatas and all that, 20 crores is nothing. But to them and to these 20,000 families in that small area of 60 square kilometers, it is all their money that they have put together. This does not belong to other financial institutions. This does not belong to the banks. It's their own money that they have saved, 10 rupees a month to now 100 rupees, 300 rupees a month, which they then give out as loans to themselves at low interest rates. And they are running a fantastic business enterprise. Three of these cooperatives are totally financially independent, and the fourth, by March 2018, will become completely financially independent. The work with children has been also going on for a long time. We've been working since 92, 93. We first started with about 15 schools, but then as the government schools started coming up and developing better education facilities in the villages, we started closing them down. And finally, now we are running just a small, we ran two schools, a day school and a residential school up to class 10 for almost 20 years. And then recently we converted close down everything, and we run a small primary level school for children who absolutely need protection and need help from very marginalized families. We also have the Mogga program, where we work with about 2,000 kids from about 45 villages, and we basically talk about ecological rights of children and the youth, because we as adults have been really destroying everything that is their heritage. So we've been trying to get them to understand that it is their heritage and they must fight to keep it alive and kicking. We also have a children's resource center, which is quite a nice place. It's a space that is completely available for children all the time. It runs 24/7, 365 days a year. This has about 15,000 books, computers, games, where children can come and play indoor, outdoor games, and also all festivals are celebrated in this center. Just some photographs of children having fun. We teach them how to do firefighting, because this is one of the most important things to do when trying to save the forest or regrow or regenerate the forest. They do theater performances. Every year we have one theater performance on any particular subject, which they take out to the villages and give a message. And then, of course, they have a lot of fun all the time. Then they have youth sangha meetings where they discuss everything. They have children's parliament to the sangha activities in that area. And they learn gardening, organic gardening, and farming in their spaces. This was our first program that we really started, and for which I was given the Ashoka Fellowship. And this work in 93, we started in a small way in a village called Mushtikoila. And there we started doing basically two things. One is restoring the traditional water harvesting structures. I don't know if you know about this, but Anantapur district has possibly one of the best water harvesting structures in the world. We have over 300 large tanks up to 500 acres in size, and these were built 500-600 years ago. And you know, Bangalore was famous for its tanks, and almost all the tanks in Bangalore have been ruined, and therefore your water situation here is becoming bad to worse. Well, we had over 300 such tanks in Anantapur district, and we have been trying to regenerate and revitalize these tanks. This is one of the tanks, the Mushtikoila tank, which is a photograph from 1998. That's how the tank is. This here is a Mushtikoila village, this one. And this is it's a classical, what is known as a permaculture design. You have the higher lands here, you see, are completely deforested. In a proper situation, this would be the forest area. And the water coming down from these hills would be pristine and very good. Even up to 70 years ago, these people from the village have told me that they used to get three crops. There's the ayakat of this tank is all this, about 600 acres. It goes right up to here. It's about 600 acres. And I've been told that they used to get three crops from this. Today they can barely get one crop, because these tanks are all silted up, and the forest cover has gone, and land has been, you know, tilled in the upper reaches of the valley. At the same time, we started the Tree Growers Cooperative. It was initiated at then and only registered in 2010. And this now protects about 9,500 acres of wasteland, which has been brought into a bioreserve. And it has about 1,200 members. So this is what I was trying to explain to you for juniors there. it will be important to know that this is a watershed and this is a tank. Now this was designed 600 years ago. Those guys really knew what they were doing. Below this tank, there are 7 tanks. So the first flow comes into this tank and then goes into another tank and then into another tank and another tank till it comes to a big river. And below this is all the agricultural land. So no electricity, no pumping, nothing was required. You had 600 acres of crop being grown without any of these facilities, just by all the water that used to come from these 10,000 hectares of land. And we have been protecting this piece of land. This is about 7,500 acres, and further up on that side, it's about 2,000 acres. This is being protected by 11 villages. This is one of the earlier photographs of this Kalpavali land, as it's called. You can see that little hut there. That was our first watcher's hut that we built. I have my friend, old Cottonian here, Pradeep Estevas, who has been seeing this for the last 25 years. And that's how it looks like now. Now, and that's another photograph of that place. Now, this has not only just brought back the trees and the grasses, this is basically a grassland ecology area. And there are, of course, not everywhere we have trees like this, but we have many types of grasses. I mean, anybody interested in botany should really come there and have a look. In this area, there is over 200 species of flora that has come back. There's about 120 varieties of birds that now have come back. We also have the gray wolf, the Indian gray wolf, totally in the whole country. I think there are about 5,000 or 3,000, I can't remember. In the Karnataka region, there are only 555 of these animals left. Worldwide, this is considered to be an animal that is going extinct. And it has come back into this area, along with the wild buck, the black buck that we have, also known as the Indian antelope. So you have multiple varieties. You know, I don't have the stats in my head right now, but we have mammals and we have these little creatures like the frogs and the snakes and others. There are many different varieties that have come back here. So it has become kind of a bioreserve that is being protected by the people, community supported. There's no fencing, there is nothing. The only problem is that the government doesn't understand the importance of this work. So what is it doing? It is giving off these ridges to the windmills. There are 90 kilometers of roads that have been put through this place that has been protected for over 20 years now by the people at no cost to the government or anybody on their own. And it's such an important space that has been created in a place like Anandpur district, where the government just is giving off these lands to these wind companies because it's green energy. And then we have all the birds dying and the bats dying and, you know, I can't say anything else. But about 25,000 to 40,000 sheep graze on these lands every year. More than 6,000 head of cattle graze on this here. There's more than 20 crores worth of grass and other produce that is taken out of this place for livelihoods of people. And this has to be recognized by the policymakers as how important this work is. This is possibly one of the only places all over the world where in an area like this, this kind of protection has been done in a grassland ecology. Our work with people with disabilities is also very important, but a comparatively younger piece of work. We started in 2001 We formed a cooperative of the people of with disabilities. We have about 1,200 members now, 1,500 members. We work on basically three things. We work on livelihood enhancement of the people from the cooperative, home-based rehabilitation work, and of course their entitlements from the government. Some photographs of the home-based rehabilitation work where our therapists actually go to the houses of these kids who need training, who need help in hearing and other aids. We have an early intervention center which is there freely available for the kids to come and stay for as long as they want and play there. And some of the marches that we have to do advocacy work. Our work on organic farming now has become very well known and famous, and a large part of our work that is being done there. I will not go into too many details about this, but we basically this started when we ourselves started experimenting and trying to understand what was farming, organic farming. We took about 7 years, 6 years before we actually took it out to the people till we were convinced that it can be done. So in 2005, 2006, we began working with the farmers and started doing organic farming. Today, like I said earlier, about 12,000 acres has been brought under organic farming with about 2,000 members in the cooperative that was promoted. So these are some of the millets. We are growing 8 types of millets in our place. As you know, millets are extremely good grain that we should be consuming. And especially for those who have become diabetic, please convert to this. It's very good. And you know, in organic farming, we don't use any chemicals. We only produce biologically safe concoctions to help us do this. We use the cow dung and cow urine a lot. And these are the farmers. We have farmer field schools that we organize. There are farmers who have been trained and are, I mean, you know, they are exceptional farmers who themselves conduct these schools in the villages so that any problem can be solved by the farmer regarding their crop. This is a farmer with his millet crop. This is a udra crop or barnyard millet. So when we did all this, we decided, we also found that if we can help the farmers to go into organic farming and they are producing this really good food, they must be also able to sell it. And so then we started thinking that we must start getting into the whole business of business. You know, people like us have always been trying to keep away from business because it's a bad thing, and you know, it's always cheating. That's the only thing. And then we've always been so scared about the market. The market is going to come and gobble up all the people that we are working with, you know. So fight the market, etc., etc. Then at some point we realize that it's pointless fighting the market because it is here to stay. So we might as well start engaging with the market, but we need to engage with the market from a position of strength. And so we formed the cooperatives. And the first of these cooperatives that started engaging with the market forces outside was the Dharni Farm Co-op, which has which product and brand is called Timbaktu Organic. And now there are 2,000 odd members, about 77 lakhs as their own share capital and investments into this. They have assets worth about 2.53 crores, and they are doing business all over the country. Basically, they do procurement, they conduct exhibitions, they do demos of, you know, how people have forgotten how to eat millets and eat traditional food. So we do demos. So this thing was started in 2006. We registered it in about 2008. But we went into loss for about 3-4 years. By the time we actually started making some profits was in 2012-13. Now, this year, or the last year, we have crossed the 2.53 crores threshold in revenues. This is a farmer's, a small farmer's cooperative. This is... two-acre dryland farmers to 15-acre dryland farmers. These are the poorest of the farmers. And they are able to run a business organization of this caliber. All of you will be able to buy these products anywhere. We have these available. That is the Timbaktu Organic team. So what is extremely important to for me to say here is this, because this is our USP, that the farmer must earn as much as possible. You do know this, I hope, that the farmers of India are the lowest paid workers in this country. We have cheap food in India. That's great. But it cannot be at the cost of the farmers. And that is exactly what happens here. And so what we've been trying to do is that for every 100 rupee worth of product that the Timbaktu Organic sells, at least 50 rupees goes back to the farmer. And that is only been achieved by one cooperative, and that is Amul, the milk cooperative. There is no other cooperative in the country or business organization that gives back 50 rupees out of 100 rupees back to the farmers. And that is what we want to carry on doing. Yeah. So now we sell the products to about 246 stores all over the country. There are about 25 of them in Bangalore. You can go to the website, timbaktu.organic, and you'll find, you can actually locate the store all over Bangalore. I think there are about 25 of them here. There are there in Chennai, they're in Delhi, in Calcutta, and all over the place. There are approximately about 45,000 people who consume this good, clean, and fair food that is grown by Timbaktu Organic. Also, I must tell you that the Timbaktu Organic prices are possibly the least in when compared to all the other organic prices all over the country. These are some of the products. We have 74 products being produced, ready to eat, ready to cook, stuff like this, including honey. Our honey is one of the best in this country. Our groundnut oil is really worth having. Anyway, the next cooperative that we decided to convert into a business cooperative was the Agricultural Laborers Cooperative. And this one has about 1,000 members, I think. And this provides loans to its members to buy and sell sheep and goat. Yeah, this is one of the most successful of the cooperatives that we started. These are all agricultural laborers, people who may own land but less than 2 acres of land. They get most of their earning by doing agricultural labor work. So they have been buying and selling sheep. They've been buying sheep, growing them, or buying goats, growing them, multiplying them, and then selling them. And currently, yes, there are 1,000 members, but they have their own capital of about 1.3 crores, which they will become completely financially independent by March 2018. And hopefully, they will have started a good live meat business by then, and hope some of y'all can access it. This is some of the goats that is there. The next one is also pretty nice. It's pretty unique, and it's a cooperative which is going to be registered as a cooperative. It is an organization of young women who weave cloth, mainly khadi cloth, and the designer for that is here, my daughter, Molly. And these are the kind of cotton, khadi, saris, stoles, and other produce. So they have about 16 products, different kinds of products, and they are considered now one of the finest products known as Timbaktu weaves. Then we decided that we should go into soap. It's a very mundane thing, you know. I mean, we all use soap, and all the people in the villages use soap. The problem is the kind of soap that we use is actually bad soap. If you notice, the soap does not have the word soap on it. It'll be called bathing bar. This is Lux and Lyril and Dove and all these things. They're called bars. They're not called soap, because by law, soap is only that which uses vegetable oils. And almost all the other soaps and soap-related products are made from petrochemical waste. And that's what we apply to our bodies, to our clothes, to everything else. So what we are doing is to try and make soap that is also made from organic produce, from oils that are grown in and produced in that area. And slowly, that is becoming one of our important business enterprises, and hopefully by another year or so it will become a full-fledged business enterprise. Thank you.
Bablu, Wing Commander Butt, known as Kojak, 66 Pope. I must say, it's an amazing insight that you've given us all. I'd love to visit your place. And I had one question, but the second has come as a, you know, query based on what you answered just now, which raised a doubt. My question to you was, why did you close the schools? That's one. And then the second query was, well, if the East India Company came and impoverished those three states of Bengal and Orissa and Bihar by removing all these handicrafts, why the hell didn't the government think of reviving it and encouraging people like you? Thank you.
I can't really tell you why the government did not do what it should have done. Basically, it's the economic model that we have adopted. I mean, that's the only explanation I can find. Because I don't think the people who are making all these decisions are bad people. I don't think they are stupid either. It's the choice. Once we make a choice to follow a particular economic model, we just can't do anything about it. You do know that the American government gives over 500 subsidies to the farmers. The French government gives over 800 subsidies to the farmer. The Indian government is not allowed to give any subsidies under the WTO and GATT. And whether it is BJP, Congress, Communist, anybody, so long as they decide to follow that economic model and they join up with the international forces, they have to follow it. That is a rather large question. We can talk about it later. But the fact remains that the hands of the government is also tied, because they have decided to take a particular economic model, which has its pros and cons. I mean, we are doing very good as an economy. The Indian economy seems to be doing phenomenally good. Of course, it's doing good. We have some of the richest people in the world. We have some of the finest industries in the world, etc., etc. But you should know that the disparity levels are the same as 1920s now. It actually, the disparity levels had fallen in the 70s and 80s, and they have gone back to the 1920s. Okay. The schools, why did we give it up? Well, you know, it's difficult. Over 27 years now, we've been raising money. I mean, I keep telling everybody, we are ace beggars. Because we go around begging for money. Please give some money, please give some money. We are doing some good work, please give us some money. Just like I tell you all, please give us some money. But doing that over the years, trying to raise money for running these schools is really difficult, believe me. But the truth of the matter also is that the government of India, especially what we see the government of Andhra Pradesh, has been building schools, good schools, with more facilities, etc., etc. I don't accept their style of teaching or their methodology of teaching, but then schools are there. Yes. Four.
Bertie Vaz. First and foremost, let me thank you for the talk that has started making me feel good and hopeful for our country as we go forward. My question is relating to your work around empowering women. Now, ours is essentially a very patriarchal kind of a society. It doesn't matter where we are in India. How did you deal with that particular aspect as you did that particular work of the women?
Well, that's really my partner's work. You know, I can't take the credit for that. Mary Vattamattam from Kerala, unfortunately she couldn't come here today because she's very busy. She's the one who started the whole work. It was difficult. But it was the way that we went by how. You see, Mary and me have been working in the villages for, I told you, about 40 years. And in that area, we also were known. We were quite well known. And so it wasn't really so easy for the men, when Mary called for a meeting of the women, for the men to really oppose it. And then when the women started getting stronger, they started opposing the men if the men started interfering in what they were doing. So what the women have gone ahead and done is that they have tried to convince their men folk that they're not fighting them. And that is a very important distinction to make. They have been trying to find dignity for themselves and for their children and for their husbands and for their men folk and their families. They are not trying to fight the men. That is not the job. Today, the women members of these cooperatives are actually highly dignified women. I mean, some of them are now, we have about 15 sarpanches, you know, village presidents. We have about 349 ward members who have been elected representatives and are action-oriented women who are running the villages. So slowly the leadership is building. And of course, they can bring home 100,000 rupees loan without mortgaging anything from these alternative banks. So of course, their value in the family and in the society is quite a lot. They can sanction funds. When the directors of these cooperatives, who are the women from Dalit families, you know, who own 2 acres of land, are able to sanction 10 lakhs to 10 different women who have applied for loans, it gives them a lot of power. Question five. Here.
My name is Ravi. First of all, I wish to compliment you on your achievement. your contribution to society is unimaginable. I have two questions, sir. First of all, how far you have succeeded in the area of sanitation? That is one. And second, how safe are the farmers or the villagers? Because we hear of Naxalites, the Naxals, between Telangana and Andhra. This is my second question.
I must be quite honest, we have done almost nothing on sanitation. I mean, we've tried to do many different things, but sanitation is something that we have not been able to go into, like many other things that we need to do. A group of people, an organization can do that much. We've not been able to go into sanitation much as we wanted to, and we should, we will, I suppose, at some point in time. The question about Naxals and safety of the people, actually people don't have a problem with Naxals. And in the Anandpur police books, I am a Naxalite. So, I had to 6 months go underground because of the work I was doing, and they called me Naxalite, where I've never held a rifle in my hand. And the information that we get about Naxalites, according to me, and I have traveled a lot of the places that there are so-called Naxalites, is misinformation. And the people in the villages are not worried about Naxal. That's not a threat for them. It's a threat for others. Question six.
My name is Major General R. Suresh. My wife and I have been supporting an organization called Chiguru. And they teach special children. Oh. The question is, does it have anything to do with your organization?
No.
And the second part is whether your whether this can be registered as a name as such, separately.
Should that organization?
First of all, thank you, Bablu. My question is a bit negative, I should think. From vested interests around. Have you faced anything that we never heard of it from you?
It would be difficult to go into all those so many details, but there are vested interests everywhere. And whenever you do this kind of work where one class is pitted against another class, when one caste is pitted against another caste, when a type of work is pitted against another work, you have problems, like we fight any mining operations we would fight. Well, the windmill operations we've been fighting. It's there. People feel threatened, then they try to act. So it's part of this work, you know. There's no great stories really about this to say. The Naxalites never attacked us, and the people we work with have been doing okay. There have been some incidents, but it just happens and then it again dies down. So,
eight,
yes, eight, microphone.
My name is Firoz Barda. 1952 batch.
Whoa.
So I think my claim to fame is I'm probably the oldest person up here.
Wow. Wow.
It shouldn't make a difference to you. Bablu, I wish to also echo a lot of things people have said. We people in the urban areas, we hardly have any exposure to this kind of a portrayal. And for that, I'm truly grateful. I'm going to ask you one question. On two instances, you showed us denuded land, and by some magical transformation, it became green. Right? In the intervening period, you would have had to use a lot of resources, primarily water, probably helping in getting a new layer of sand or whatever. You never really touched upon that. Would that have been a very big challenge?
I did say that we didn't do anything. The whole onus and the whole kudos should go to Mother Nature, because all we did was protect her. That's all. And believe me, nature has incredible skills of regeneration. She can regenerate. You can just take my word on this. But we need to protect her. We need to give her a little bit of help, like, you know, don't allow the burning to happen. Don't allow overgrazing to happen. Don't allow people to cut those bushes that are coming up. And slowly, slowly, it regenerates by itself. The birds come back. First the grasses come. You know, then the better types of the I forget the word. You know, you have the pioneering grasses, and then you have the more high developed grasses. Then the birds come. And after the birds come, they bring in the seeds. And there are also roots that can lay dormant for 50 years. There are seeds that can lay dormant for 50 years. If the right kind of an ecology comes about there, they sprout and they come back. I showed you from 21 species, more than 400 species have come back. It's not because we went and planted there, not because we went and put soil there or we water, or we did nothing. We just protected. And in doing so, nature re-showed her beauty. That's all. Yeah. Nine.
Bablu. Can you hear me? Yeah.
Yeah.
Timothy Franklin, 1998 Pope House captain.
Wow.
So my question. Pope House? No, no. I have. One broad question with two aspects to it. One is, from what I see, I think your Timbuktu branded products, I mean, they sound fantastic, and I think we should all encourage that. Now, but because of that, I see that the earnings of farmers have gone up from 35% to 52%. What mechanism do you have in place to make sure that those margins, because I think the spread is still 75% is what you need, right, before it gets into the retailers. Do you have, as you scale up, is there a way for that number to go up from 52 to say 60%, 65%? And the second part is, because of this increased earning, do you see that for farmers in your area, that the level of suicides have come down?
Yeah. Well, what we have done is very little. It really is in the hands of the government. And we are doing what we can because we live there and all these people live with us, and we are trying to do what we can to get them to earn a little bit more money. We are also doing this and trying to create a situation where young people will want to come back to agriculture. When the children of these farmers go into the schools and they study school, college, they immediately want to get out. Their parents don't want them to do agriculture because it doesn't earn them any living. They don't want them to go around with sheep and goat and look after the sheep and goat because it's a very dirty kind of thing. But by doing this, they are beginning to come back. Many of them are coming back because the earning seems to be going up. Yeah. As we go up, I told you that the USP for the cooperative has to remain 50% must go back to the farmer. And we have to be able to convince the consumers, the eaters, that look, you have to pay for this food. Please understand that you're not paying us, we are not making any profit from this. But the farmers must earn more money. They have to earn more money. You know, in the US, 3% of the population is in the rural areas are doing farming. In India, just imagine if the 50% who are left come into the cities, what will happen? It's impossible. There is no way we can do that. We have to keep farming going. We have to keep animal husbandry going. We have to have rural crafts going. That is the only way possible. There is no way that we can urbanize at the rate in which India is urbanizing. And to do that, we have to create this possibility. And I hope that over time, you will be able to buy things just because they are good food, this is clean food, and it is fair. That people must get the fair price for the work that they have done. If you come and see the work that the farmers do, you'll be shocked at how low they earn, how low they pay themselves. When I went 40 years ago, 100 kgs or 45 kgs of groundnut was worth 400 rupees. Today, it is worth 1500 rupees. You know, it's not a huge difference. It has only gone up two and a half times. But when you look at the wages or the salaries earned by most of the people in the cities, it's like huge, but we are paying the same small price for the food. We have to pay more. We have to recognize that this is good food. If someone is going good food, giving fair wages, then we must give them also that kind of support. Right? I mean, I think that's what you asked. I mean, someone had asked what's the difference between the Timbaktu Collective and the cooperative, Dharni cooperative, yeah? So Dharni is a cooperative. It is owned by the 2,000 odd members who are the share capital, shareholders of that. All the cooperatives, the 13 cooperatives we have set up are owned by the people who have put in their share capital there. It's not owned by the Timbaktu Collective. The Timbuktu Collective is an NGO, it's a voluntary organization that is promoting these cooperatives and allowing them or getting them to become more and more independent and free of our support. Yes, so none of our members have committed suicide. Dharni members have not committed. None of the Gram Sri cooperative, all the 13 cooperatives, we are working with 21,000 families. Nobody in those families have committed suicide. But women have been killed. That's a separate issue. There's violence on women, violence on children, violence on people with disabilities. And it is as strong there as it is in the cities. And that is something that we have been trying hard to work on. These cooperatives of the women, they run their own legal system where any member can come and put a case and say, like, we need help. Then the women's cooperatives then take action. They call the men and they ask them to explain why they are behaving in the way they are doing. And if they are not willing to stop what they are doing, then a case is filed and they are taken to court. So the women's cooperatives do the work on women with violence, etc. 10, I think General Paul had a question.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
Firstly, I think it's safe to say on behalf of all the ISC students seated here, we'd like to commend you on the work that you've done with the Timbuktu Association. My question for you is more of a request, actually. I was wondering if you could probably have maybe a tour or you know, sort of a trip that you could take us to the Anantur region.
Sure.
Because it's very enlightening. I mean, there are a lot of bio students here who said that they were very interested in the botany. And so. just wondering.
How many want to go for a wolf walk? Whoa. Okay, but you have to ask one of your teachers. So it's actually quite simple. It's very simple. Our email, our website is timbaktu.org, and you just have to go there and inform us that you want to come. We have 3 days every 3 months, but we can always organize something for the students of Cottons. So if the teacher concerned can write to us and tell us that so many kids want to come, they want to do this, they are most welcome. We will organize something. Yeah. General Paul.
Well, sorry, I just want to ask one or two short questions. One is that you didn't cover the medical health side in your collective. There must be something in it. And your project, I will call it a project, such a successful one. Is there many more similar projects in the country? Is there more Bablus in all over India? That's what all.
I am just one among hundreds and hundreds of people who are working in the villages across, not just villages, also in the cities. And there's a website called vikalpsangam.org. Is it Vikalp Sangam, Ashok? Pradeep? Yeah. Vikalp Sangam. Go to that website, and they are documenting all these projects all across the country, from Kanyakumari to Leh to Ladakh. We have been holding meetings, getting all these people together and getting them to document what they're doing, because it's time for us to start hoping. Actually, there's a lot of hope. There are lots of people who are trying to do lots of different things. It's just that it's also disparate and also all over the place, that many people don't even know about such things. If they came to know, then maybe they would all join up in some way or the other. You know, you don't have to come and live with us in the villages to be part of Timbaktu Collective. You can support us in many different ways. So similarly, there are lots of people working all across the nation, in the Northeast, in the West, in Rajasthan, in the middle of the deserts, in Kashmir. All over the places, there are people who are trying to do alternative things and trying to generate a whole reason to hope. The other question of yours was on health. It's like the question here about sanitation. Health is something that we have not dared to touch, because it's such a big thing, and it needs so much money that we have not been able to. The other thing is that doctors just don't come there. Doctors nowadays only want to live in the cities, in the urban areas, and they have paid lakhs of rupees for that education. They want to earn that money fast. Even though I tell them that if you charge only 10 rupees per person, you'll still be a millionaire within 2-3 years, they don't listen to me. So they don't come, because there's no recognition, there's no comfort as you have in the cities. And most of these young people who are passing out from medical colleges refuse to come to the villages and work. And even if we do set it up, it's really, really expensive to run medical, you know, camps. Even running camps is extremely difficult.
Bablu, one last question. Yep. I can't refuse the chairman of the OCA. He'll disqualify me.
Ganguly, thanks a lot for that talk of yours. But I must say that this is a point that which you had just mentioned, what the Naxals, what we've been hearing in the outside world, what I heard of the past was that dacoits of the Chambal Valley were more helpful to the villagers than the government themselves. Do you experience the same thing from the Naxals in that score?
You know.
Thank you.
Thanks. You know, if you invite me once again, I'll give you a lecture of 4 hours on Naxals and what Naxalism means and the history of Naxalism, right from Naxalbadi to Srikakulam to here, because it's one of the worst understood words or concepts. And what the media has been talking about and what the government wants us to think about Naxals is completely different. And I can talk about it, but it takes a long time because I need to start from the beginning to make you understand or make people understand what does Naxalism mean and what it may have degenerated into. There are many different forms of it. There are lots of people who have used the word Naxal and the whole concept has degenerated. But the Marxist-Leninist form of Naxalism is something I can talk to you about. Whether the dacoits of Chambal were more helpful than the government of India, these are all, you know, perceptions. I'm sure the government of India and the government of all the states in many pockets have helped many people. It's not that they are all, you know, it's not that everybody is trying to make money and putting it into the Swiss bank and everybody is corrupt. It's not true. There's lots of good work has gone on. And lots of government servants are extremely dedicated people who have done super work. And a lot of them, because they could not do anything, they came out of it and carry on doing. Like Aruna Roy, for example, is just one person I can think of. But there are hundreds of them. So lots of work has happened. The government has many right intentions, but wrongly placed. Great policies. India has some of the greatest policies in this world, but we are unable to implement it. So it is a complex thing to say, you know, whether the Chambal Valley dacoits or whether the Naxals did better, I don't know. But one thing I do know, that we are following the wrong economic policy. Of that I am absolutely sure. We don't need to export. We have 1.5 billion people here. We don't need to export. This is complete hogwash. China has proved it again and again. And yet we don't, we want to, you know, tie hands with these countries and then we want to export, and our economy is understood to be strong or not strong depending on how much we have exported, which is crap. We don't need to do that. But we have made that choice. And if that is the choice, this is going to happen again and again and again.
Bablu, on that note, I want to thank you for a memorable, memorable morning. Your candor and your sincerity of purpose and indeed your life's work has just come through so effortlessly. There are concepts here that I think academicians would struggle to explain, and just the economic depiction of how you have changed farmers' lives so seamlessly has inspired many of us. To the boys, the message now I think is very clear from an old Cottonian. It's not about career choices, it's about life choices. Bablu made these choices early, and the dividends are here to see. So don't stop at just a field visit. Pester him for internships. I mean, I can tell you, personally, I've had the privilege of sitting on the Rhodes interview board, and almost everyone who's from the social sciences side highlights the fact that they've interned with the Timbaktu Collective. So please make the most of it. It's been a wonderful morning. We've really made you sing for your supper. We do have high tea, but before we adjourn, could I request KC Belyappa, General Thimayya's grandson, to please felicitate Bablu Ganguly.
Violence on children, violence on people with disabilities, and it is as strong there as it is in the cities. And that is something that we have been trying hard to work on. These cooperatives of the women, they run their own legal system where any member can come and put a case and say, like, we need help. Then the women's cooperatives then take action. They call the men and they ask them to explain why they are behaving in the way they are doing. And if they're not willing to stop what they are doing, then a case is filed and they're taken to court. So the women's cooperatives do the work on women with violence, etc. 10, I think General Paul had a question.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
Firstly, I think it's safe to say on behalf of all the ISC students seated here, we'd like to commend you on the work that you've done with the Timbuktu Association. My question for you is more of a request, actually. I was wondering if you could probably have maybe a tour or you know, sort of a trip that you could take us to the Anantapur.
Sure.
Because it's very enlightening. I mean, there are a lot of bio students here who said that they were very interested in the botany. And so, just wondering.
How many want to go for a wolf walk? Whoa. Okay. Okay. But you have to ask one of your teachers. So it's actually quite simple. It's very simple. Our email, our website is timbaktu.org. And you just have to go there and inform us that you want to come. We have 3 days every 3 months. But we can always organize something for the students of Cottons. So if the teacher concerned can write to us and tell us that so many kids want to come, they want to do this, they are most welcome. We will organize something. Yeah. General Paul.
Well, sorry. I just want to ask one or two short questions. One is that you didn't cover the medical health side in your collective. There must be something in it. And your project, I will call it a project, such a successful one. Is there many more similar projects in the country? Is there more Bablus in all over India? That's what all.
I am just one among hundreds and hundreds of people who are working in the villages across, not just villages, also in the cities. And there's a website called vikalpsangam.org. Is it Vikalp Sangam, Ashok? Yeah. Vikalp Sangam. Go to that website, and they are documenting all these projects all across the country, from Kanyakumari to Leh to Ladakh. We have been holding meetings, getting all these people together and getting them to document what they're doing, because it's time for us to start hoping. Actually, there's a lot of hope. There are lots of people who are trying to do lots of different things. It's just that it's also disparate and also all over the place that many people don't even know about such things. If they came to know, then maybe they would all join up in some way or the other. You know, you don't have to come and live with us in the villages to be part of Timbaktu Collective. You can support us in many different ways. So similarly, there are lots of people working all across the nation, in the northeast, in the west, in Rajasthan, in the middle of the deserts, in Kashmir, all over the places. There are people who are trying to do alternative things and trying to generate a whole reason to hope. The other question of yours was on health. It's like the question here about sanitation. Health is something that we have not dared to touch because it's such a big thing, and it needs so much money that we have not been able to. The other thing is that doctors just don't come there. Doctors nowadays only want to live in the cities, in the urban areas. And they have paid lakhs of rupees for that education. They want to earn that money fast. Even though I tell them that if you charge only 10 rupees per person, you'll still be a millionaire within 2-3 years. They don't listen to me. So they don't come because there's no recognition, there's no comfort as you have in the cities. And most of these young people who are passing out from medical colleges refuse to come to the villages and work. And even if we do set it up, it's really, really expensive to run medical, you know, camps. Even running camps is extremely difficult.
Bablu, one last question. Yep. I can't refuse the chairman of the OCA. He'll disqualify me.
Ganguly, thanks a lot for that talk of yours. But I must say that this is a point that which you had just mentioned. What the Naxals, what we've been hearing in the outside world, what I heard of the past was that dacoits of the Chambal Valley were more helpful to the villagers than the government themselves. Do you experience the same thing from the Naxals in that score?
You know.
Thank you. Thanks.
You know, if you invite me once again, I'll give you a lecture of 4 hours on Naxals and what Naxalism means and the history of Naxalism, right from Naxalbari to Srikakulam to here, because it's one of the worst understood words or concepts. And what the media has been talking about and what the government wants us to think about Naxals is completely different. And I can talk about it, but it takes a long time because I need to start from the beginning to make you understand or make people understand what does Naxalism mean and what it may have degenerated into. There are many different forms of it. There are lots of people who have used the word Naxal, and the whole concept has degenerated. But the Marxist-Leninist form of Naxalism is something I can talk to you about. Whether the dacoits of Chambal were more helpful than the government of India, these are all, you know, perceptions. I'm sure the government of India and the government of all the states in many pockets have helped many people. It's not that they are all, you know, it's not that everybody is trying to make money and putting it into the Swiss bank and everybody is corrupt. It's not true. There's lots of good work has gone on. And lots of government servants are extremely dedicated people who have done super work. And a lot of them, because they could not do anything, they came out of it and carry on doing. Like Aruna Roy, for example, is just one person I can think of. But there are hundreds of them. So lots of work has happened. The government has many right intentions, but wrongly placed. Great policies. India has some of the greatest policies in this world, but we are unable to implement it. So it is a complex thing to say, you know, whether the Chambal Valley dacoits or whether the Naxals did better, I don't know. But one thing I do know, that we are following the wrong economic policy. Of that I am absolutely sure. We don't need to export. We have 1.5 billion people here. We don't need to export. This is complete hogwash. China has proved it again and again. And yet we don't, we want to, you know, tie hands with these countries, and then we want to export, and our economy is understood to be strong or not strong depending on how much we have exported, which is crap. We don't need to do that. But we have made that choice. And if that is the choice, this is going to happen again and again and again.
On that note, I want to thank you for a memorable morning. Your candor and your sincerity of purpose, and indeed your life's work, has just come through so effortlessly. There are concepts here that I think academicians would struggle to explain, and just the economic depiction of how you have changed farmers' lives so seamlessly has inspired many of us. To the boys, the message now, I think, is very clear from an old Cottonian. It's not about career choices, it's about life choices. Bablu made these choices early, and the dividends are here to see. So don't stop at just a field visit. Pester him for internships. I mean, I can tell you personally, I've had the privilege of sitting on the Rhodes interview board, and almost everyone who's from the social sciences side highlights the fact that they've interned with the Timbaktu Collective. So please make the most of it. It's been a wonderful morning. We've really made you sing for your supper. We do have high tea, but before we adjourn, could I request KC Belyappa, General Thimayya's grandson, to please felicitate Bablu Ganguly.
I'll do that, sir. I do want to tell the present Cottonians that the reason I'm doing what I'm doing is, I think almost 70% of that has to do with cottons. I really must say this. I spent the most important formative years of my life here. I spent only 3 years here, mind you. But those 3 years was from the age of 14, 15, 16. And at that time, we had some of the finest teachers, I must tell you. We really gave them shit. But those guys were able to take it, you know. I mean, you look at Shankar sir here. I mean, all of them, Mr. Nainan, Ms. Rukmani. I mean, we really gave them hell. But they were able to inculcate into us certain extremely strong points. And I must say that this fearlessness of going and working in a place that is completely different from what you've grown up in, I could have only done it because I went through cottons. I tell you this I owe this to cottons, and I will say it again, that confidence was given by cottons. Thank you.
Thank you, Bablu.
Next dextrosum, next sinistrosum.
Thank you, Belly. Thank you again, Bablu. Ladies and gentlemen, your appreciation for Bablu Ganguly. maybe take a moment to recognize our patrons. Admiral Shekhawat. Admiral Shekhawat, former chief of the naval staff and an old boy who has recently moved from Jaipur to Mumbai and hence couldn't be with us today. General S.K. Jaitley, unfailingly with us from Delhi with Mrs. Jaitley. Could I request O.C. Manav Nagraj to present General Jaitley with flowers on behalf of the trust, please? Thank you, Manav. Thank you, General, for being with us. Mrs. Jaitley, thank you for being with us. Air Marshal Osman, who had to suddenly leave town, our Air Force patron. And of course, we fondly remember our past patron, the late Air Marshal Mally Wallen. Friends, it's time to close. We will have time for high tea after this, so feel free to continue your cross-examination of Bablu. I saw that there were many hands up. I want to take a moment to firstly thank Mrs. Rubin, the Vice Principal of Bishop Cotton Boys. If you're here, ma'am, could you please stand up and be recognized? Thank you, Mrs. Rubin, and thank you all teachers and representatives of Cottons. We thank Professor John Zachariah. Unfortunately, he had to leave for an urgent meeting of the Anglo-Indian Schools Association. I want to thank all veterans who consistently support us. Thank you for being here, folks. Friends from the Kumar Regiment, General Thimayya's regiment, it's wonderful to see you here, Colonel Uthaya, as a representative. I want to specially thank friends who are here from far and wide. At the top of my head, I can recognize Mr. and Mrs. Zachariah from Chennai, Mr. P.M. Bellyappa, Group Captain Chit Karyappa and Devika from Delhi, and my classmate and friend Ajay Nityananda, who's from Tirunamalai. Tiruvannamalai, thank you. And in fact, much of the work that Ajay is doing, he's catching up with Bablu. Many other friends who've continued to support us, thank you for being here, old Cottonians, present Cottonians. And may I request you for your feedback, because we're trying a change of format, as you've seen. I hope you've enjoyed this afternoon, this morning. For me personally, it's been a coming of age for the lecture. Having Bablu share his wonderful like experience, I think, is unparalleled. Thank you once again. I want to recognize my trustees. If you could step forward, please. Prashant, Lokesh, Ashwin. Self-effacing. CN, Rajiv, and of course our youngest trustee here, Riyan Ahuja. So on that note, may I request you to stand for the national anthem, and we look forward to having you at the 14th lecture.